Okay, we're back with the second part of our little raid we've been doing here. Scenario, what is this? It's EV4 Alert 5, which is a funny sequence. I don't know why that trips me up. Numbers sometimes trip me up that way. Maybe some of y'all think backwards too with numbers or letters like I do. Anyway, I was looking up some rules in the interim break because while you may have just watched the next video and no time has elapsed for you, it's been a couple of hours. I went and had lunch. And I was thinking about some things that happened during the combat we had here, including the disordered states and how really crippling that is for our Spectre aircraft. Because if you are disordered, you can't engage in air-to-air combat. And honestly, I looked at the table and really it just goes to show how perilous air combat really can be for your units in the sense that it is very easy for them to become disordered. You really have to roll pretty high on the morale table to actually avoid this. Where is the morale table? Yeah. I mean, you have to roll very high in the morale to get a no effect. And one of the other things I didn't quite note is that because we had a disordered result, we would have dropped all of our ordnance if we had any air-to-ground ordnance. So technically, this Hafiz unit has no more ordnance. It's done. So I'm going to note that on my little sheet here, even though we already know it's not going to be able to do anything, right? Because it's pretty much can't ever recover from the sword roll. We didn't put a rally point in, and I probably could have put a rally point in. It probably just would have made this a little bit longer and a little hairier, but you know, to keep it simple, I didn't. And honestly, if I had to put a rally point in, it has to be 10 hexes away from my target. It has to be either rough terrain, like a urban area or part of a river. It has to be like a recognizable geographical feature. And because he's been attacked, you can deviate off your path because you've been attacked. That's the rules. So I could actually have him sort of wheel around and head back to some sort of rough point, maybe over here or reconvene up here and sort of rally and then come back and attack. That's really not important because honestly, that's why we had two flights. And it honestly makes me think that's why the scenario rules let you perhaps split up the Israeli flights into two flights of two planes each. Because then you get less concentrated firepower, but you're able to take on two different targets. And as we can see, getting a disorder result is pretty much going to make him fairly null in terms of the ability to really disrupt this unit, which is on its way to bomb the airfield. So anyway, just some thoughts I had. I need to move this guy over here. He's still medium. Okay, so we're on to the next part. We're going to roll for random events. We get a 9, and that is going to be... Quick reaction alert. If the Egyptian aircraft, I'm just going to say Egyptian because EAF is, you have to really pronounce it. If EAF aircraft had been detected by any means, the IAF player may enter 1x2 Mirage 3CJ flights anywhere along the east edge of the map during the movement phase. This flight is tasked for a cap mission. Increase the CGI by 1. Because the rules say, of course, that if you have more cap missions in your CGI level, then your CGI level decreases because you just have more aircraft in the airspace and it's more difficult for your ground controllers to really do their job, you know. So that's sort of why that rule applies. This lets you get away with that. And it looks like we're going to get some extra airplanes. Do I get to have this rule happen? Yeah, this one is allowable. So I'm actually going to get some, what does this say I'm going to get? I'm going to get a 1x2, so one flight of 2 Mirages anywhere along the east map edge. So that's over here, right? Down, this is the east edge. So, interesting. Let me dig out a Mirage flight, and when I come back, we'll figure out where that's going to go. Okay, back for part 2, or actually, we've already been back a little bit for part 2. Sorry, it's been a day since I recorded that first part when we rolled... The event, the special event, what was it? It was Quick Reaction Alert, number 9 there. So the IAF players, you know, magically, actually probably very helpfully, is about to get a flight of 2 Mirages. So we've got that here. I picked this guy. It's going to be, what's his name, Maram. But of course, he will come in undetected and non-identified because that's sort of, the Egyptians don't know who they are yet. They're going to have a blip. They're going to try to figure out where that's coming from. And I can bring them in on any Eastern Hex edge. And I looked up the rules and I didn't see anything that's about how to deal with flights created this way. So what I went ahead and did is just sort of made him a carbon copy of the other Mirage flight, except it'll just have two flights. So it has the same armament. I rolled for aggression. It did come up plus two. And it's on a cat mission, because that's what the random event says. So I went ahead and just sort of did that. And I also didn't see anything that said about any kind of movement restrictions that, this aircraft would have. The event just says it appears during the movement phase on the eastern edge of the map. So I'm going to rule that it just can have full movement allowance. I'm going to guess that maybe it had sort of some sort of fuel tanks and was flying around. I mean, we'll make up any kind of thing we want to make it work. But I'm going to go ahead and rule, because I didn't see anything in the rule book, that this flight's going to be able to come in a movement and be able to expend the full movement allotment that it has. So yeah, we just did that random event. So we can actually continue on with our next phase, which is going to be detection. Let's see, is there anybody undetected? Yeah, we still have this Hafiz. It went undetected ever since the battle in which both it and the Mirage, the Spectre, call sign Spectre, became disordered, as you can see the tokens here. So let's go ahead and see if we can get that detected. Nope, it still remains undetected. Rolled a six. Okay, so then we go to movement phase. The Israeli player will choose... They're going to choose to go first, because we're going to bring this flight in. Let's see if I can back this up a little bit so I can get the entry hex set up. Oops, I kind of have a little... There we go. All right, so where do we want this guy to come in? Because, you know, luckily he's going to be able to intercept this one remaining MiG flight that still has bombs and is still careening towards the airfield. So I think what we're going to need to do is just bring this bad boy in. I think he'll come down maybe here. It'll give us the full ability to really sort of intercept. I could try to go behind him, but it's just going to take, I think, too long to get behind him and really do damage. So maybe I'll just come in here. Yeah, because that'll give me the ability to sort of sweep in and maybe go get him. So he shows up, and of course we know he's a Mirage. My opponent wouldn't necessarily know that because it's undetected. We're going to rule him as being clean again, because I'm not sure if you have air-to-air weapons if you are ruled as laden. I only saw things that said if you had ordnance, which is air-to-ground attack. So we're going to rule him as clean. And basically, he gets straight-up four movement at all levels. Oh, I guess I get to choose what level he comes in at, don't I? Let's see. Yeah, it doesn't say what level it comes in at. So I think what we'll do is we'll go ahead and say he comes in at a medium level, which I need to get another token out for. Yeah, we'll go ahead and rule him as being medium. And so he will actually use... I don't know if I really want him to do a dash throttle, because he really just has to do combat throttle. I think I don't really want him to overshoot the target. And he gets four movement anyway, so I think we're just going to do that. So he's going to use his four movement, and he's going to go one, two, three, four... Yeah, that's going to give us the ability to, and then I think he will turn. He'll get a free turn, I believe, of 30 degrees, maybe 60. 60 degrees free turn, so he's actually going to turn this way and face that corner. Yeah, because then this thing can by, we can wheel around and really get him. I think we can, yeah, that'll work. Yeah, that'll work. Is that actually how I want to do that? Yep, that'll work, okay. Yeah, we'll see about this. He has to... See, the thing is, you wouldn't know necessarily this is his bombing path. You might know that, but that's a pretty good intercept. So we'll keep that guy there. Spectre, unfortunately, still is disordered, so he's just going to continue going straight. And he will use also just combat speed. He is also clean. We're going to just use... we can use up to four or one less. So we'll just use three movement, and he'll go one, two, three. Gotta get these guys. Normally, if you had more guys, this would be much, you would just, it would be better off almost keeping track of this. Oh, I should probably get a little closer and move up there. We'll see you in just a second. Oh, I guess he's over here, isn't he? There we go. I'm going to zoom in just a bit so we can get a little bit clearer picture of what's going on. Yeah, with so many other planes on the board, you would probably want to keep track of this more on your sheet. I'm sure the altitude you'd have to keep on the marker itself, but the disordered or whatnot, you'd probably want to keep track just up on your sheet. Anyway, okay, so he moves there. This guy's moved. Oh, You know, I'm dumb. I was supposed to pick out, see, I've already had a day go by and I've forgotten. So what would have happened actually is we would have had to draw a chit, right? And in this case, we've only gotten one guy to move. So I would have moved that guy. So let's move this guy back three spaces. One, two, three, yeah. He can just stay there. All right, so then we would go and draw a chit now for the Egyptian Air Forces. And they're going to draw also a one. And we're just going to have this guy continue on because he needs to go. So actually, I probably should have gone second with the Israelis there. That probably was a mistake to actually go first because I could have been able to come up here and actually done some damage. He has to continue at his medium height and speed. So he's got only a three speed, I believe. Yes, he has a three speed. So we're going to go just three more spaces. One, two, three. He most certainly will be attacked, but this was just unfortunate. Not much he can do. Hopefully he doesn't suffer any ill effects. Although I doubt we'll see if he even gets to have a bombing run. That would be unfortunate if we don't get to, if we don't get a bombing run in. I'll still do like a fake bombing run just so we can actually see how that works out. Okay, so they both went. Nobody used any fuel. There's no SAM locations, and the admin phase. The only thing we can really do is roll to get rid of the disorders, and only the Spectre unit can actually, or call sign Spectre can. Get rid of his. I think he still needs, he needs a 19 or 20. And he gets a 10, so not good enough. Okay, so then we go to the next turn. So we're going to do a random event. It's 11. Delayed attack orders. EAF flights may not initiate air-to-air combats this game turn. Psh, not a problem, because we're not trying to initiate air-to-air combats. We have a detection phase going on, so again, we'll try to detect this flight for the Israelis. They do not. They roll an 8, and we'll see if this flight can be detected. It's a 12. I don't think that's high enough for them to be detected. No, just one short of what they need, because they have such a poor... they have D level. One thing I can do, though, is to try to do a visual ID on this person. So let's see if I can get that to go. Let's see what kind of modifiers I would have. Don't have multi-crew, and it is nothing else really happens. I'll show you just again. We'll take a look at the modifiers here for the search, and we'll be using the visual one. So you'll look and see where the visual column. I'm going to have to use that, so... Kind of needs a pretty high roll to get this visual. No, so we don't even get a visual sighting on this guy. Okay, so that was detection. Now we go to movement. The Israelis will want to move first, so let's see if they actually draw a movement chit. If not, we're going to have some interesting turn here. Ooh, look at that. They do draw a zero. So they got a zero. That means we're going to now shift back to the Egyptians. And they will draw a one. So they're actually gonna keep this guy moving, the MiG 17. We're about to enter our bombing run, and what we're gonna do is a dive bomb. So let's actually talk a little bit about different approaches. So when you do bombing runs, you actually have various styles or approaches you can use when you get there to attack the target. So let's go ahead and get to that part. Okay. And there's actually on the rule book, there's a nice little summary. I've just sort of made notes here for myself about what different ones are. There's, as you can see, dive bombing, level bombing, radar bombing, toss bombing, strafing, and then, of course, the anti-radiation missile, EOG beam attacks, which, what are those for? It's the 3X. Yeah, I wonder, I'll have to look at that one up exactly. We're doing a straight-up dive bombing one. It's pretty easy. The initial point, that's what IP is one hex away at either low or higher. So we're at medium, we're good. We can press this for positive modifiers, but the flak will receive bonuses just before the attack if there is flak available. And there will be, as we can see. So what we do is we basically go one, we've entered here. And so the flak actually projects a flak zone in the six hexes around it, sort of like a zone of control, but it's a flak. And so now we need to see if we can actually hit that. So we consult the AAA table here. We see that our target is at medium height, and this is a medium flak battery. So we need to roll a 17 or higher to get a hit on this guy. And we did not roll that. We rolled a 15. Oh, were there modifiers? I guess I should see if there are modifiers. No, there's only modifiers if there's an air-to-ground attack going on. So then we come here. Two. And now we're going to, once again, take another flak roll. He's gonna roll pretty high. Once again, does not get it. Gets an 11. And then we move here, and then we get another flak roll because we've once again entered another hex in its zone, and then we can actually do our bombing run. And we do not get hit with flak there either. Okay, so now we're actually gonna conduct the bombing run itself. So we consult the air-to-ground attack charts, which I think is in the blue maybe. Yes, okay. Oh boy, so this is a fun chart here. As you can see, I don't even know if I can get it all in this camera angle. There it is, the air-to-ground attack table. Lots of different things we need to look at here. So the most important thing we need to think about is what's going to be the strength of our attack. And we're going to use, we have a flight here of four flights. They all have 0.5 worth of bomb strength. We can use 0.5 increments, as many as we want on the target. We're going to attack the runway. The runway, according to the scenario rules, has a target profile of B, but because we're using runway dribblers, we actually get like a 3x modifier on our attack. So let me take a break and actually read this. I want to make sure I get this right without babbling too much on the videos. So when I come back, we'll actually do the dive bomb attack here on Refidum. Okay, so I made just one small mistake. When you use runway dribblers, you can't do a dive bomb attack. You have to do a level attack. And a level attack can only be done... I just have this on here, hold on. Use bomb ordnance for a visual bombing attack. It's one hex away, no climb or dive permitted, and apply the level bombing modifier. So, okay, I guess we're okay then. Thought I could only do this at a certain level, but I just read that. Yeah, being at medium, unfortunately, I think we're just going to give us the most negative modifier, because you can't be at high to do it. You need to actually kind of be a little lower. So we actually should have actually maybe gone a little lower, but that's okay. We'll just sort of rule this, right? Maybe we'll just say they didn't want to take the risk of actually getting another flak roll for having to actually decrease. Because if you do anything like move or decrease your height or anything in a hex, you get another flak roll. It's just another opportunity for them to fire at you. So we actually won't do that. What we'll do instead is we'll just stay medium and we're going to declare this attack here. So what we're going to do is you look at... That's right, right? Yeah. So what we're going to do is we're going to look at our attack value. And the way we calculate that is we're going to remember that our flights, each plane in it has a bomb strength of 0.5, and we know that from looking at our aircraft data sheet. Right here, right? So we look at sort of the MiG-17, we can see its bomb strength is 0.5 there. So we take that and we multiply that by the number of flights we have in attacking. So we have the number of aircraft in that flight that are attacking. So we have four aircraft times 0.5 gives us a value 2. Now, since we're using runway dribblers and we're attacking a runway, we get to multiply our strength by 3. Runway dribblers would be only half strength against any other target, but against the runway, we get to multiply it by 3. So we take our value of 2, we multiply it by 3, and we get 6. So what we do here is we look at our back to our attack table here. We look at the 6 column there, and we see different values. So what we're going to do is we're going to roll our 2d10, and we're going to apply the modifiers here for the... left column, or actually all of those, because it can be for dive, level, radar, or toss. And so what we're going to get is basically the target profile is what? I believe it's a D. Or let me take a look, actually. Oh, no, it's a B. So for the modifiers, we're going to get minus 1. We're going to get minus 3 for attack for medium. So it's our minus 4 total. I don't have a flak modifier yet. I wonder if we're gonna, we could actually get a flak modifier, so I need to look at that. So far we have, what do we have? Minus 4, and we're doing level bombing, so it's minus 6, and nothing else is happening. So let's see what the flak modifier is. Yeah, so if we do the AAA table, we see the flak modifier for a flight at medium is going to be minus one. So we have minus seven, I believe, right? Because we had minus six before. Let me double check that. Should have written that down, of course. Minus one for me, target profile B, minus three for medium, that's four. Yeah, level bombing six, and then the flak modifier is going to be seven. So we're going to take 2d10, and we're going to subtract seven from our roll. All right, we got 18, so a very nice roll to actually get. 18 minus seven, of course, is 11. So we go back and look at our six strength attack table here, and we see that 11 results. What is that going to be? Three. So yeah, we just got a nice little value there. So what we're going to do is mark this target with a three value damage. If I can find one, oh, there we go. So we say Refidum has now a three damage marker on it. Okay, so that was that attack. We actually used up all of our bombs. I believe we don't have to, yeah, so what we do here is you would actually mark that you've used the bomb strength, and since we know each flight used theirs, we're gonna mark each one of the little boxes off. All right, so that way we know we used them all. Okay, so that was that guy. We get to now go back to the Israelis. They were not able to actually get this plane intercepted in time, because they drew a zero chit, so they get the one chit here. And they're gonna have their 208 flight just come around and start attacking this from the rear, because they're basically gonna have just slipped by them, but that's the way it goes. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna do a turn for one of our movement. And we're gonna go that, that's one, two, we get 60 degrees free turn, one, two, and then we go three, four, and we can engage because we're adjacent. And we actually get some nice little bonuses because we're attacking them from the rear, even though this guy, you can't see that actually, he's got that going on. Oh, there was actually a medium flat concentration there. I don't know if I rolled for that. I was just thinking, well, the truth is if they have overlapping, you take the one that's got the best ability to attack, and so that was going to be, they're both medium, so it wouldn't really matter, actually. Something you got to think about is a lot of these targets actually have inherent flak zones around them. And so, yeah, something I didn't really think about. But, of course, since it's already had medium flak around it, it's going to be okay. Okay, so we're going to attack this guy. So we're actually going to do another attempt to attack. What do we got to do here? We need to see if we can even engage. So we need to roll die. We look at our engagement table here. And we have different modifiers. It is a detected flight. We get to add an aggression value of 2 because that's what he got. Not in a different altitude band. Not. Oh, we're in the rear hemisphere, so we get to have... Actually, it's not. Oh, we get... what is it? We get these modifiers. Oh, that's what we get. Oh, it's for the maneuver roll. This is not for the engagement roll. For being in the rear, being in our enemy's rear, we actually get a bonus on our maneuver table for how many shots we get, not necessarily if we can engage them or not. That's a very interesting distinction there. So it's not in haze that the target is in rear hemisphere. It's not. Target is making a slashing attack. No. So yeah, we just need to roll two die and get a greater value than 9. So let's roll. The attacker rolls an 18. He does engage. Let's see if the defender is going to actually roll a 20 with our aggression value modified there. So let's see what we got to do here. Now when we roll for the Egyptian flight to see if it engages, it's going to take some nasty negative modifiers because its aggression level is, I believe, minus 1 already. Yeah, it's a minus 1. And it is the target is in the rear hemisphere, so it's going to get a minus 2 to its roll. And it rolls an 11, and that becomes a 9, and that is, and this thing is undetected, so actually that is not good enough. That means we're going to have a interesting differential here. Let me take a look what that means. I believe that means we get surprise, which is not going to be good for this guy. If the attacker engages but the defender does not, combat commences and the attacker has surprise and the defender is disadvantaged. Move the attacking flight to the defender's altitude band. So we're already okay there. So now we look at our maneuver table and we consult the different columns, and again we're going to be using the EAF flight is going to have to use the column of two because of the Soviet restriction, that sort of that rule there, that the unit is a two-plane unit attacking prior to 1973. So what we do is we roll for both of these guys, and we see what kind of shots we get with different modifiers thrown in, which are located here, and we also get some of that. So let's see if we can get this all together. For the Israelis, they are going to have four, or actually have two aircraft attacking. I forgot, this is a smaller flight. And let's see, we get a maneuver differential. What is our maneuver differential? So the MiG has already dropped its flights, or dropped all of its bombs. So it actually gets a clean value here, and it's at medium, so its maneuver value is 5. And the Mirage's maneuver value is 6, so it actually gets a +1 modifier there. The aggression is where it's going to get killed. It's going to get a +3 there, so already at +4. The geometry means we get a +1 because we're attacking from the rear, so we're at +5 already. The enemy's not disordered or close formation. We have surprise, so we're at +7 because it's a +3 modifier there. The enemy is disadvantaged. It is, so that actually is... Actually, we only need to add those modifiers, right? So we're at +7. And the enemy could choose to disengage. Like, he honestly could use this disengagement, and what that does is it essentially gives them more negative modifiers. It makes it easier for the attacking aircraft to shoot at them, because they'll get more of these modifiers for disengaging if you do. The only difference is that if you disengage, you don't get marked with a maneuver marker, and you don't scatter. So there's a chance that you basically won't have to pay a lot of your MP next turn, and you won't have a... the ability to become disordered or have your plane move, right? Because that's kind of what happened to these guys, right? Because they engaged in air-to-air combat and went through the whole process, they had to roll in their morale check. And so if you do this, you actually don't do that. We're just going to keep it going. I think we're going to try to press our luck here because it's only two flights and we've just dropped our bombs. So it's not a huge thing, right? But he does get a 7. He does get a 7 modifier on his roll. And that's not exactly great for us either. So let's take a look here. All right, we got a 7, we got 2 aircraft. Let's roll our die and see what we get. He rolls a 10, so he gets a 17. For 2 aircraft, that means we get 3 shots. All right, and for the other aircraft, it is, of course, going to mark in the 2 column. The Egyptians are, because of their Soviet rules. Their differential is going to be nasty. They're going to get a -1 to the roll because their maneuver is worse. Their aggression, they're going to get... -3, so we're down to -4. They get a -1 for being attacked from the rear, that's -5. And we are disadvantaged, that's -6. So yeah, we get a -6 to our roll here, total. Well, that's not bad, actually. Roll a 15, -6 is 9. And 9 or less, it gives them 0 shots. They don't get to fight back. That was close, but we actually didn't get to do it. So this attacking aircraft gets 3 shots on the MiG. We will be using our... we will be using our one missiles, our, what do we say we have? I even wrote this down, right? Yeah, we're going to use the Shafir, we're going to use that Shafir missile because he actually has it. So let's try to see, we get 3 shots. So we look at our shot resolution table. And we have an undepleted weapon, we roll 2 die and apply modifiers. And the modifiers can be the combat value of the weapon. It's going to be 0 because these are early weapons. And the flight has additional undepleted weapon, and we do. So we get a +1 to our roll here. So the first shot, we roll a 12, we get +1, has no effect. Second shot, we roll a 9, +1 is 10, no effect. Last shot, man, roll a 9, +1 is 10, so no effect. Man, we didn't, all those weapons, and we didn't get any shots out on them. So we've used all of our shots. Let's see if we actually run out of the ammo here. So we actually fired, 2 shots beyond the first. So we get a -2 to our roll. I roll a 10, -2 is 8. And I believe, yes. So we actually get to keep those missiles because you can see their depletion value there is 6. It's hard to see probably right there, the Shafir. Or Shafar, I'm probably mispronouncing that so bad. There's not an I in there. There's not a, it's probably Shafar or Shafar or something. I don't know. I'm going to butcher that. I'm really sorry. I've been calling it Shafir. It has no I in it. Anyway, it's got a value of 6. We rolled an 8, so it actually stays undepleted. That's helpful, I guess. So now we do sort of the resolution of the combat, of air-to-air combat, which let's go ahead and look that up just to make sure we get that right again. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to check for morale. All attacking and defending flights in air-to-air combat roll a morale check after combat has been resolved, even if no shots occurred by either side. And flights that also take damage or losses from AAA, fire can, gun dish, or hawks also make a morale check. So we go to the morale check table. Where are you? Got to remember kind of where all these tables are at. Ah, there it is. Morale check table. So we are going to, of course, apply our modifiers as appropriate. And first thing we're going to do is we're going to roll for the Israeli flight. It rolls a 19. Wow, that's really good, actually. And the modifiers are we get to add the aggression value. It was plus 2, so he's at 21. The flight did have surprise, so he's at 23. And that means he basically gets no effect. So he's still cruising. He's rocking. His morale is really good. Let's see how good the Egyptians are. They roll an 8. That's not great. they get to add their aggression value, which is negative 1, so it becomes a 7. They were disadvantaged, so it becomes a 6. And nothing was damaged, though, so luckily for them. So they get a 6. That becomes disordered, and their aggression value goes down minus 2. So he's definitely, luckily he's already gotten his attack off, or else he's pretty much going to be worthless now. He wasn't already a strong pilot necessarily. Now he's definitely going to be very weak. So he goes from minus 1 to minus 3. You can see I note that here on my sheet. Kind of got messy sheet writing. I bet other people are much better at this, but did a minus 3 there for that MiG 17, the Y counter. So his morale is not great, and he also becomes disordered, so we need to mark him with a disordered marker. That's okay, he did his mission, he accomplished everything he needed. If only the Israeli flight had been able to catch to it first and had won the initiative, or actually drawn an initiative chip that was greater than 0, they would have had a chance to really attack them and have them force them to drop all of their weapons, because of course, a disordered result, as we can see, it says the same thing as effect for jettison, and if you look at jettison, flights with ordnance immediately jettison, and the flight loses a close formation if it had it, and we modify the aggression value as indicated, so. It almost had to abort, but now it pretty much is already done anyway, so that's okay. But it gets a nice disordered result, and the Israeli flight does not. Okay, so we did a morale check. Now we do a scatter check. First we're gonna do, I guess, a MiG panic. Nah, we don't have to do that because there's no other flights tasked with bombing that actually still have ordnance. Everybody's dropped theirs or already used them. So now we do scatter. For each flight in combat, we're gonna look at the scatter chart and roll it. So let's start with the Israelis. We can see here that they're facing straight on in a hex, so and as I so took so long to figure out, that means we're gonna be using this chart. So we roll 1d10, rolls a 10. That's interesting, he basically goes backwards that way. So he goes, what, to his back right? Yeah. What is that? It doesn't go right behind him. Yeah, he just slides over a hex, right? Yeah, wait, no. If he's facing... Sorry. my spatial reasoning is really bad sometimes when I'm upside down. I don't know, maybe I'm crazy. So we'll just go ahead and put this up so I can actually think about what I'm doing here. Yeah, that's exactly what it's got to do. Wait, no. Does that make sense? Yeah, it does. Okay, I'm just being dumb. Okay, he slides over here. Stays undetected, right? Because actually this guy will flip to undetected too, right? Because air-to-air combat means you stay undetected. Or you flip to undetected, right? Because of the whole idea of the radar being disordered or whatever. So let's see where this Egyptian flight goes. He rolls a 7. That means he's going to basically go... What is that? Up into his right? Yeah, so he shifts up to the right one. So he goes up here, and he's disordered. And that airfield has been successfully attacked. Okay, so that was all the movement there, and I guess we saw this Israeli flight, or this Egyptian flight. Actually, what we do is we go pick up another chit. If he gets a 0, then the Israeli guy will move, but he didn't. He got a 1. So this Egyptian flight will continue doing what it wants to do. It's going to use just... combat throttle, I guess it could use dash throttle, honestly. We might as well just use dash and get the hell out of here, as they would say. So dash throttle for a clean plane at medium altitude is going to be 4. Yeah, so he gets 4 movements. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to speed away. We're going to go 1, 2, 3, 4. Actually, you probably can't see that, can you? There we go. So he speeds away. And that leaves only this plane left, and it's going to use... And so I'm going to go ahead and mark that fuel usage for that one, because, again, it used combat throttle. And also I need to mark the fuel usage for the two flights here that were involved in combat. So we mark our new Mirage flight gets a fuel usage, and the other one gets a fuel usage. Okay. This guy is just going to use, I guess. I guess he's just going to go maybe... Well, there's a chance he might not get disordered, so yeah, we'll just have him keep flying straight at his regular speed, which... Being clean at medium, at a combat speed is 4. So we're going to go 1, 2, 3, 4. And we'll free turn 60 degrees. So he goes 1, 2. How tight is that? Okay. So his idea is he's going to try to wheel around and maybe try to get this flight as it comes back up and attack it again, if it can get out of its disordered status. Okay, so that was everybody's movement. So we did the fuel phase. I've already sort of noted the fuel costs. We don't have any SAMs. So now we do the administration phase. So we got to roll to see if we get rid of this disordered. And he still needs to roll, was it a 19 or 20? And he rolls a 12, so not good enough. And of course, this flight can't ever hope to get out of disordered state because of its aggression value being so crappy, and we don't have a rally point hex, but that's okay. Because he's at medium too. We need to kind of sort of keep that together. Okay, so that's the end of that turn. So we go to the next turn, and we're pretty much getting to the end of this raid here. We roll, what is that, a 16? That can happen, and that is an IAF commando attack. The EAF detection level shifts one column right for the remainder of the scenario, so that means, disregard if scenario takes place during 67. So normally it would make our ability to detect this flight even more difficult, but since it's a 67 scenario, those commandos just don't have the ground to be launching attacks that would actually divert or hurt our intelligence capability, I guess. Okay, so then we move on to movement, and the Israeli player will go first. He gets a 2, so they're going to get to move both their flights, and this guy's going to continue to just come and attack that guy. He's going to go normal speed. He's going to come 1, 2, and actually get in his hex, and we're going to attack him again. So we roll for engagement. I'm starting to get this down. I'm starting to feel it. So again, if we look at the engagement table, we just need to roll a 9 or higher, and we have some different modifiers there. I think that won't be too hard. Yeah, so we automatically roll a 12. We get to add our aggression value. So we engage. So let's see if the Egyptian flight will engage. And it actually has some nasty... Oh, we didn't do detection. So I actually should see if I can detect... Because he's undetected, I actually can't engage in air combat on him. It has to be a detected flight in order to engage. So actually, I've skipped the whole detection phase because I got a little hasty there. So let's actually go back and see if we can detect these flights. Let's see if the Israelis first can detect this guy. They don't use their radar, but this guy can visually sight... I guess he's already been visually sighted, so actually he just has to remain undetected, so that means he won't be able to actually get a combat on him. That's too bad. Let's see if the Egyptians can. They roll a 13, and that is just good enough. If those commando raids had happened, that would have been not good enough, but there we go. So now he can actually be engaged, but this flight can't engage this one because they don't quite know where he's at. That seems kind of absurd. He could get a visual ID on him, which we can roll on, but he actually has already been visually ID'd. He's just undetected right now. And if you remember, visual detection does not equal detection. That's a visual ID, I should say, does not equal detection. And detection does not equal a visual ID, right? We've got a detection here, but we don't know that that's a Mirage flight. I guess technically we would know that's a Mirage flight. I lied, because he did do an air-to-air combat, so he actually would have revealed the fact that he was a Mirage. Okay. So I kind of goofed that, but I fixed it. So what that really was is that when we did that air-to-air combat, he still would have been undetected, but I would have had to reveal that it was a Mirage flight. And now with his successful detection roll, he actually knows everything about that flight. Okay, so that was actually a big roll for the Egyptians there because they managed to avoid detection, and that so this flight can't actually engage that guy. So we got this movement. There's not much we can do with it. I have to move somewhere. You can't just like stop moving because planes have to keep moving or they would just fall, right? He gets four movements, so we'll use three. And I think what we'll do is we'll do a turn here of 60 degrees. So we'll go one to face the angle and two to face downward. Then we'll go, that's one, so that's one movement. This is two movement. We'll do another 60 degrees, and this is the most we can do. One, two, and then we'll just do three movement here and just stick that hex. Let me move this guy's little markers. So his whole goal is eventually just swing back around and hopefully catch this guy as he runs away that way. And maybe we can get him detected by then. And then the Spectre, of course, can move four, and I think he'll just move three. And what he'll do is he'll just go one, two, three. He'll stay there. Now we go to the Egyptians. Obviously, they get to move everybody they want because the Israelis have already done all their movement. This guy is now free to do whatever he wants. He's done his attack, or he did his bombing profile, but he also was attacked. So he actually gets freedom to do what he needs, and he's basically going to start getting the hell out of here. He's going to go do dash throttle now. So we're going to do dash. He gets movement with a clean value at medium. It's going to be four. So that's what he's going to do. He's going to go one, to do a free turn of up to 60 degrees, right? So he goes, faces that way. Now he faces the point, and he's gonna go three, four. Yeah, he's just gonna come there and kind of hang out. And his idea is he's gonna start turning and heading back to the airfield as well. This guy's gonna use his regular values, I guess four. He's also got a four, right? Even just his, no, that's his combat would be three, I guess, for the clean at medium level. He's going to go ahead and use dash. He's going to go four because we're just going to try to get to this airfield really quickly. Four, that gives me a free turn of 60. So what we're going to do is we're going to go one, two, free turn 60. So that means we go, we'll actually just free turn 30 and then go three, free turn again, four. Yeah, so he goes up there. Okay. So what are we gonna need? Yeah, so that's that, guys, and that's the end of that turn, right? So we go to the admin phase, we try to see if Spectre here gets undisordered, and he does not, he rolls a four, so we move on to the next turn, and it's random events. Seven. Dust double. A localized dust storm creates haze on the deck, rule 1d10, if it's 1 to 8, the EF player chooses where to go. And if it's 9 to 10, the Israeli player chooses where to go. The Egyptian guy will choose, and the thing is we already have haze on the deck, not in that one place. Where's my haze markers? I wonder if I have another haze marker. I bet I do, but I don't know where it's at. Real Sam launches. Huh. Maybe I only have one haze marker. I don't know. Well, for shits and giggles, we'll just ignore that. I mean, honestly, I could put the haze around here. He's going to get a nice little bonus on haze. If he was in that haze, he's not going to. So I could actually put that haze like right here. So we'll go ahead and just mark that. I don't know where that marker is, but I'll just go ahead and say like, hey, there's a haze there, so that's going to give us a nice haze on the deck. Although we're not at the deck, so it doesn't even matter. That's okay. Okay, so we did that, so we got a roll for detection again. So we're looking to see if the Israelis can detect this flight. Oh, they do. They roll an 18, so he is now in trouble because he's been detected. And they're already good to go, so there's nothing to roll there. Oh, I guess we could see if we can get this guy, even though he's way up there. Nope, and we get an 8, and we don't detect him. So now we go to movement. The Israelis will try to go first again. And they get the 1 they need and not a 0. So this flight is going to try to engage. We're going to use combat throttle. So that is going to be at medium. That is a 4. So what we're going to do is we're going to turn for our first movement. And at 4, our max turn is going to be 120 degrees. So we're going to go 1, 2, and actually I think that'll be good enough, right? Yeah, that'll be good too. So we'll go, so that's first movement is 1, the move there's 2, move this 3. I get a free turn, 30 degrees. And then we'll go 4, so we'll attack there, because we actually we have that ability. So let's try to roll engagement rolls, because it actually can be seen. Again, we down to roll. It's going to be pretty easy. Oh, but we roll a 6. Plus our aggression value is 2. The target is in haze, though. Oh, no, he's not in haze, because he's above it. The flight is disordered, so it's actually... What do we roll there? 6. I have 8. Nope. Nope, it's not going to be enough. So actually, I do not engage. And let's see if the... and the Egyptian flight will just simply disengage. I don't think he's going to try to stay in this combat. So we're not even going to roll for that. And if I disengage and he doesn't engage, I believe nothing happens. I believe that's the way that works out. Yeah. If neither attacker nor defender engages, no combat takes place. I could choose to engage if I managed, if I wanted to, but I don't even want to do that. So, no combat takes place, actually. So that's really funny. That plane couldn't just quite... It gets close to the gap, but it just can't quite do it. So he misses his opportunity to fire. We go to the Egyptians. They get a 1. And he's just going to also use... dash throttle, so I'm going to go ahead and mark that on my chart here. He has a lot of fuel to burn, so he can do that. That means he gets to go, I believe, 4. You think I'd remember this every time I do it. Dash at medium is 4. So he's going to turn 30 degrees first, puts him straight on here, and then he's going to go... So that's his first move. That's 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so then we go to... Well, there's only one other Israeli flight, but if they get a 0, I guess they wouldn't get to go. So let's see. They draw a 2, so the Israelis will go. And really, they just have Spectre, and he can't really do much, so I think he's just going to try to wheel around and try to get this guy too. So he's just going to take 3 movement. He has up to 4, but he's just going to use 3. So he's going to go 1, 2, 3. And he'll just kind of wheel, and he'll get a free turn of 60 degrees, right? Yeah, so he goes 1. 2. So yeah, that way he can wheel around too and get this guy. And then finally we have this flight up here, and he's just going to use combat throttle because he can't dash and land, so we're going to use combat throttle here, and that is 3. So he's going to take, what is he? He's going to go 1. He's going to get a free turn of 60, so he goes 1. Actually, he's just got to do that 1. This is 2. He's going to take a free turn of 30, and then he's going to go 3. Yeah, so he's almost ready to land on the airfield. And that's the end of that turn. Yeah, because these guys both moved, he moved. All right, so you can see we're really getting close to the end. We roll now for random events. That's going to be a 12. Fuel starvation, but nothing. Nobody's crippled or damaged. Ooh, that could have been good, but nobody's crippled or damaged. Everybody is detected except for that guy, so we'll go ahead and see if we can see him, although he's about to land. And they don't see him. They roll a 10. And the Israelis will attempt to engage again, so... Oh, I didn't roll. Oh, I forgot about this. Should have gone back and seen if he loses his disordered status in the admin phase. He does not. Okay, so it didn't matter. All right. And I guess this guy, we should keep note that he is disordered, and he is at medium. And I don't roll for them, because there's just no way they could get a roll. The Israelis opt to go first, and they get a 0. So that wasn't so good for them. And now the Egyptians will go, and they pull a 2, so they're going to move both their planes. And this guy's just going to use dash throttle, and that's going to be 4. So let's go ahead and mark that fuel usage. And he's just going to get that all out of here. And what he needs to do, though, is he needs to be careful, because if you see up here, there's a light flat concentration here in these hexes, right? So he needs to get the hell out of here. He's going to go 4. So he's going to go 1. He gets a free turn up to 60. Or 30. Is it 30 or 60? He gets a free turn up to 60. So he goes 1, two. Yes, and then this is his second move. Third move, he's gonna turn that way. Fourth move, yeah. So now he's on target to get back to the airfield. And then this guy's just gonna use his combat to begin landing. So he's gonna go one, and he gets to go that way, two, and he's gonna begin landing. Okay, let me make sure, let me look up landing, because it shouldn't be that hard. Let's make sure we get that right. I might have to descend, actually, because he's at medium. I think I have to go to the deck, so he might have gone there. That was his second move, and then his, he will just descend to low. I think I can descend to any level I want, right? I can dive to any level, so yeah. He would actually dive down to the deck and then goes there, but let's double check that. Landing, 9.14. Landing takes 3 game turns. Once landing has begun, the procedure cannot be stopped or interrupted. To begin, the landing flight must be on the deck and at combat throttle. On the game turn landing begins, the flight may select any speed between 1 and their maximum. The flight must end movement in a hex adjacent to the airfield. So I guess he had to have gone there and stayed there. The flight must end a movement and with it in the forward arc and point in the same direction as the runways. On the next turn, instead of regular, it just advances onto the airfield hex. And on the following turn, it lands. So yeah, it's a three-part process, just like our one here. Okay. So now the Israelis get to go because the Egyptians got to move their flights, and we're gonna have this guy, now he's gonna have to actually start catching up this guy. So we're gonna use dash throttle with this dude, even though he doesn't have a ton of fuel. He only has 6 fuel points and he's used 1 already. So he's gonna go dash. We're gonna have a good old Marin here go dash. And his dash value is gonna be 6 at medium. So he actually can really turn here. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna go 1 with a speed of 6, though. Ooh, but our ordnance. Oh, yeah, that doesn't matter. Okay. If you have ground ordnance and you go above 4 movement points, that ground ordnance is considered rendered inert. But we don't have to worry about that with air to air weapons. And we only get a free turn of 30 degrees, which is fine. So we move 1, free turn. So now we can go 5 more spaces. 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. We might be able to catch up with him next turn. I don't know. And then Spectre here is just going to use, I guess he's also going to use his dash throttle. Because he's going to try to catch up too. So he's going to go up to 6. He's going to get a free turn of 30. Or he's going to use one of his movement to turn 30 because I have to actually move to get a free turn. Actually, I could just do that. But I'm going to just use my one turn to get a movement. And then go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah, so he's up there, but he doesn't have the ability to engage because, of course, he's disordered just like that guy is, too. Just like they all are. Where's my medium? There he is. Okay. Because I should get a little closer to the action now that the action is shifting upwards. Yeah, that'll work. Okay. Actually, let's get you more centered. There we go. Okay, so they've both moved, and he can't engage because he's got that disordered. So let's now, we're at the admin phase. And he still doesn't lose his disordered status. The call sign Spectre does not. So now we go to the next phase, and we're going to roll for random events. And we get a 16. And I believe we don't get to use that one. Maybe not. No, we do. Okay. 16 again is the commando attack, so that doesn't actually have any effect because it's not post 67 yet. So now we go to detection, but I believe everybody's detected except for that guy. He still remains undetected, so that's not going to help. And plus, with the being on the deck, you can't even see him, he's up there, but anyway. So the Israelis will try to go first. How many disorder points do I have? Oh, this guy probably should have had his disorder marker. Ah, they once again draw a 0, so they're just not getting very lucky here. Letting the Egyptians get able to escape. And the Egyptians pull a 1, so we will get that flight that is being pursued out. And it is going to use dash throttle again, so that is 4 movements. So we're going to mark that on our fuel sheet. I mean, there is a fuel phase where you do this, but you might as well just mark it when you use it. I don't see why you would just wait to do it, because you might forget. And the thing is, these MiGs have 12 fuel points, so they can actually do this quite a bit. They can really go dash. So he's going to dash four. He's gonna, just going to go one, two, three, four, and then he also gets a free turn of 60 degrees, so he's going to go one, two. All right, he's doing pretty well. Go back to the Israelis. They pull a one. We'll have call sign Merum because he's not disorganized. Try to come up here, but he's going to have to use dash to catch up. He might. He has to go first and actually get an attack off. So he's going to use his dash throttle again. He only has three fuel points left, so he's not going to be able to do this a whole lot. And so he gets six. He does get six movement, though. He's going to catch up. One, two, three, four, five, six, and he gets a free turn of 30, so he does that. Okay, so he did that. And now there's only one Egyptian flight left, but they may draw a zero, which they do. So that means now everybody just gets to move. So the Israelis, actually, they may draw a zero. And they do. So maybe the Egyptians will get to do their landing sequence. And they draw another zero. And so many zeros. Finally, the Egyptians, or Israelis, get a three. So they only have to move Spectre. And Spectre's just going to use a combat throttle. And he's just going to go three as well. One, two, three. And also get a free turn. One, two. There we go. So he's got a little bit nicer angle going on than necessarily Marin does. Okay. And of course, this means now he just, this guy at the top, he can't quite see because we're not the action. He's just going to begin the second part of landing, which means he goes here and does nothing else. Okay. Nerve-wracking, getting to the end here. Okay, let's see if Spectre can lose his disordered status. He does not, so I doubt he's going to get involved in this battle at all. It's up to Merim, I suppose. Okay, next turn, we do random events. That's a six. SAM fratricide. We don't have any SAM targets, so that's not going to be a problem. That actually has where a SAM site will fire on one of its own planes, but we don't have SAM, so we don't have to worry about it. Okay, once again, the Israelis will elect to go first. And they actually do get a one, so we're going to get one more attempt to get this guy. We're going to use call sign Merim. He's going to use one. He's going to use combat throttle, so he gets four. So he gets free turn, or he's going to turn for one movement, and then he's actually going to get on top of this guy and just be like, boom. He's going to attack him. All right, so once again, we see if we can get an engagement roll. All right, detected. We get a plus two to our roll. We get actually the, yeah. Yeah, we get a plus two to our roll. 7, 8, 9, we barely get it. So make sure we don't have any negatives. No, so he just barely engages. The Israeli does engage. The Egyptian rolls an 8, but he does not. So he's gonna get surprised. So we have surprise versus disadvantage going on here. That's not necessarily good for the Egyptian flight. Let's roll on our maneuver table. Once again, let's take a look at our nice maneuver table. So the Mirage flight is going to roll the two column, and so will the Egyptians. And we have all sorts of fun modifiers here. Actually, we're going to roll the one column because the unit's disordered. So the Egyptian one has to roll in the one column. That's going to be not so good for it. I don't think it's going to get any shots. So let's get the modifiers down. The maneuver differential. Oh, I keep forgetting these flights. This is something I've been kind of goofing up, and it's not great. Modified maneuver flight. Rating by one if the flight climbed, two if it zoom climbed, and two if it is marked with a maneuver marker. It doesn't have a maneuver marker, but it has climbed. And remember, if you remember, the Egyptian flights did zoom climb, so I've been kind of forgetting about that modifier. Oops. That just basically means that the other plane would have better ability to take on that target. I kind of wonder, though, because we zoom climb so early, I wonder how long the zoom climb penalty applies. I think it does apply for the entire raid. I could be wrong though, but we'll go ahead and mark it in here because I I've been messing it up, so we'll just go ahead and have that modifier. Okay. But this plane did not zoom climb or anything. It stayed at medium, so it has none of those. It has a +2 aggression differential. Actually, it's going to be +3 because this flight, the Egyptian flight, has a -1 and the Israeli flight has a +2. The geometry is going to also give them +1, so that's automatically going to be what? Oh boy. Well, let's see. We got what? +3, +4, +5 for being disordered, +3 for surprise, that's 8 already. And the maneuver differential between these two flights is just 1, I believe. Yeah, it's just 1. So, what is that, +9 to the roll? So yeah, let's see how many shots he gets with a +9. He rolls a 10, that's going to be a 19. It's 3 shots, so he's going to get 3 shots at this guy. Go ahead and roll a 3, and then, oh, that's such a, that was terrible. Jeez, that was much better. There we go. Do a little squiggle in there. All right, let's see how many the Egyptian guy gets. He's going to roll a 10, but his modifiers are going to just be awful. He's going to get -1 automatically, so it's a 9. His differential is -1, so it's going to be an 8, and his aggression is -3, so he's got a 5. And on a 1 column, he doesn't get any shots back. So what we're going to do is we're going to have 3 shots here. So we're going to now roll on the shot table, because we've determined our maneuver, we've engaged, we determined how many shots we have going on. And we're going to do shot resolution. So once again, this good old shot resolution chart, and modifiers are going to be 0 for the value of the weapon, and +1 because this flight still has undepleted weapons. So first shot, 7 + 1 is not enough. Second shot, 11 + 1 is not enough. Third shot, oh, there we go, 19 + 1. That is definitely going to be 1 aircraft damaged. Ooh. Damn, we could have got a shot down if it was 16 to 19, but that's okay. 1 aircraft unit damaged. So go to our nice little aircraft data sheet here, and we've got to mark our MiG flight, which is this guy. And what we're going to do is going to put a little mark here because there is different levels. There is what? Damaged, crippled, and shot down. So damaged is sort of the lowest level, but that's okay. I'll mark it with a little slash. We'll just do a little slash there. I think they have their own ways of doing it. I'm going to just do a slash. If it's damaged, if it's crippled, we'll fill in the box. And if it's shot down, then we'll put a circle around it or an X through the box so that you know it's just totally done. So that was the second shot. Oh, that was the third shot, wasn't it? Yeah, it was 3 shots. So now let's see if we get depletion. We're going to -2 to our roll, and it is depleted. Okay, so we do lose the missiles there. So it did manage to actually get... You can see I marked off the Shafir there for counter 208, so it has lost its things. Its value is 6, so we actually didn't beat that this time. That is okay, though. We've done our damage. So we've done 1 damaged aircraft, and that's it. Okay, now we do resolution. How we do that? We do morale checks. Where are you, morale? You'd think I would have this down by now. Okay. So let's do the morale for the Israeli flight. It rolls a 10. Its aggression value is +2, so it's 12. It had surprise, it's 13. And so it's 13, and that basically means it has disordered and it loses 1 of its aggression values. So this flight did become disordered because of that. Okay, aggression goes to just +1. And it gets marked with a disordered marker. What else do we have to do here? We don't have to do any MiG panic. All right, so now we're gonna roll for the Egyptian flight. It rolls a 9, and its modifiers are -1 for its aggression value, so it's 8. It was his advantage, so it's a 7, and it had something damaged, so that's now a 6. So it gets a 6, and that is disordered, and it loses 2 to its aggression value. So yeah, it's going down. Oh, actually, it's an abort. Its aggression value was already -3. Oof. Now it's going to be -6, and it's just going to, it has an abort mission. I mean, it was already heading home, but now it would have to stop doing whatever it did if it had an abort like that. Okay, so we've done that. I want to make sure I get this all correct. All right. Oh, I forgot to place maneuver. Oh, they didn't really actually do combat last time, did they? Oh, they might have. I might have forgotten to have placed maneuver markers last time. Oops, that's what I forgot to do. That was kind of a mistake. I should have put maneuver markers on these guys when they had their combat earlier down here. That would have actually made it more likely they could have attacked that plane earlier, but that's okay. So we'll do maneuver marker for both these guys. All right, and then we do the scatter chart. And they both become undetected, so we're gonna go ahead and flip them both over, and let's now do a scatter rolls. All right, let's take a look. Let's do the Israeli flight first. It rolls an 8, it will not decrease. Oh, I forgot to do that. If you roll an odd number, you have to decrease the altitude band, but it rolled an 8. And since it's doing that sort of straight on facing, it's going to now go up into its right. Oh no, it's actually doing that angled facing. It's doing this one, so it's gonna go up into the right still. He's disordered. Actually, they're all disordered, aren't they? Yeah, they're both disordered. And the Egyptian flight, it rolls a 10, so it's just going to slide to the right there. Actually, it can't do that, can it? Oh, it's flat on. Wait, was I doing that wrong? Oh, no, I wasn't doing that wrong. It's going to go basically back here. Oh, that's interesting. So it's scattered right behind it. Okay, and we did the morale check, we did the scatter. You don't have to do any MiG panic because that was all the flights are actually done. And okay, so yeah. So basically both these guys are gonna be disordered, which means unless these guys can roll very high values, I think the combat's gonna be done for our flights here. Even though their aggression value is still pretty good. What did he get though? He's just got plus one now. Okay, so that's all these flights, and of course, yeah, right? Did he get to move? I kind of forget if he moved or not. Oh, no, he didn't, because that was the first flight. Okay. So now we're going to get our chip for the Egyptians. And they don't get to move. So we have the Israelis, and they do get to move. And Spectre's not going to be able to do anything, I don't think. I think he's just going to go 3, and maybe he'll get lucky and be able to get this flight. So he's just going to go 1, 2, 3, just sort of maybe be able to turn and fire on that guy if he can. I don't know if that's really going to happen. Go back to the Egyptians. Actually, they both get to move because now the Israelis have both moved. This guy lands. He's done. And this guy's going to use going to use another dash throttle. And he was actually in air-to-air combat, so let's mark our fuel costs for both of those. All right, so he's gonna go dash throttle. That is, I believe, is 4 for him, right? Yeah, he's got 4 movement. So he's gonna go 1, 2, 3, 4, and then he gets turn. Actually, he's gotta go that way then. Yeah, it's just gonna stay there and go 4. All right, so let's see if these guys get out of their disordered status. Otherwise, I don't think there'll be any attacks that can actually be made. So let's roll for the Spectre. Nope, he rolls a 12. And let's roll for Merim. And he rolls an 8. So yeah, he doesn't get out of his disordered status either. So I think that's pretty much going to be the end of attacks for these guys. Let's just see one more thing. Let's go ahead and roll the next ram event. That's 11. That's going to be delayed attack orders. The Egyptians won't be able to initiate air-to-air combat. Not an issue for them here. Let's go ahead and get, now we're up here, so let's go ahead and move this up and get a little more on the action here. Hold on, I need to actually adjust this camera angle. There we go. Sorry about that. Oh, no, there we go. That was perfect, I guess. Got a new little stand, I'm getting used to it, so that didn't quite really do what I wanted, did it? That's okay, this will be fine. So we got new random events. We can roll for detection, and this will really determine if we can get this guy or not. And they do detect him, so yeah, he's back into detection mode. Let's see if they can get this flight detected for the Egyptians. They do not detect that guy, and having not gotten out of disordered rolls, I just don't think it's going to matter, so we will let the Egyptians go first. Oh wait, he could only have gone, he had the maneuver marker, I forgot, so he could have only gone two movements, so we have to move that off. So yeah, I forgot about that, you have to spend half your MP to get rid of maneuver markers. So he actually only went that far. So he gets a one, so he will get to go, and he will use regular throttle. No, he's going to use dash throttle again. He's got to, like, get the hell out of here, so we're going to mark him on there. He's not going to run out of fuel, though, essentially. He has so much fuel. Okay, and he's going to go one, two, three, four, and then free turn. One, two. 30, 60, that's all he can move, right? Yeah, that's all you can move is that. Okay, now we'll go to the Israelis. See if they get there too. They get a zero, but they have to go, so they only fly it, so I don't even know why I picked there. So he's got to spend, he's just going to go regular speed and go four. He's got to spend half of his to get rid of this maneuver marker, so it's gone. So he has two MPs, and he'll just go one, two. And Spectre will just go three and go one, two, three, but honestly, he can't do anything now, so he's going to turn one, two. Because we lose victory points for going into the Sinai up there. Okay, I really want to get this camera fixed. Hold on a second. That'll do. Oh, God. Okay. Oh, man. This is not going to quite work how I want it, is it? I'm doing a lot of shaking now. Okay, that's not coming out the way I like. That's okay though. We'll just have to pan out a little bit. Anyway. Yeah, I just don't think he's gonna be able to engage these guys. So he's moved, they moved. I mean, he has to turn now. He can't even, yeah, because we can't just spill into there. We don't want to lose any victory points. So he's just gonna do a free turn, do three movement, and go one, two, three. Yeah, I don't think it's going to really work for them. So that's the end of that turn, and we'll see if they can lose their disordered status. First one, no. Second one, no. So yeah, that's going to be the end of that one. Let's see, they may lose a flight through the random events, so we'll do one more random event roll. There's a 12. Ooh, that is fuel starvation. Ooh, let's see. So we're going to roll. And it's a 10, and that is an Israeli flight. So if he'd have rolled under 5, we actually could have had one of these flights because his damage would have died of fuel starvation. But it didn't. And so what he's going to do is we're going to have... It doesn't really matter. We'll have the Egyptians go first, and they get a 2. And he's just going to begin landing, so he's going to take combat throttles. He gets 3, so it's going to be 1, 2, and he's going to dive down. He was on medium, but he's going to dive down to the deck. And that's 3. And that's the end. So these are the very last disordered rolls that can happen. First one rolls 14, not good enough. Second one, not good enough either. So that's pretty much it, I think. I don't think the Israeli planes are going to be able to do anything, so they have to keep moving. They're not going to be able to come back around and do any damage to that flight, because now it's going to use a second turn. It's just going to move... here, and then the next turn is just going to disappear, so. I don't think they could do it. Yeah, because they have to keep moving, so that's actually not going to work. So I think this is pretty much the end of that scenario, mainly because I just know these flights are going to be able to return here and be successful. So we'll go ahead and stop it there. Let's take a look at what we did. We did get 3 damage here on the airfield at Refidum. That was pretty nice. Actually, it was a very successful attack with the runway dribblers. Managed to avoid a lot of flak rolls. Because he had to come down here and he totally avoided that flak concentration altogether. And what else do we get here? We also had one aircraft damaged for the MiGs. So what we'll do is I'm going to stop, and when I come back we'll do the end of the raid sort of procedures, and we'll see what kind of victory point totals come out and who actually won this raid scenario.